Oh, hey, honey.
Good morning.
Hey, can you hold this real quick?
Thank you.
Yeah. How many know that guy's in trouble? How many know that? See, that's what we call a me marriage. We're talking about we and relationships and we, but that is definitely a me. And pray for that guy. That wasn't even set up. That was an actual real story. I'm kidding you. I want to welcome all of our campuses. Good to have you here with us. Can we give a shout for all of our campuses? Waters Avenue and our Temple Terrace campus, and down there in Ybor was last week awesome with Tony Dungy laying a foundation for family and relationship. He did such a great job, and he is a great coach, man. He coached us up last week, and like we always say, go online. You can get all of our messages online and watch it, and then you can send it to a friend. This week, we're going to continue our series on relationships. Now, how many know that me doesn't work when you're building healthy relationships? I mean, no matter what kind of relationship, if it's about me, it's not going to be healthy in that setting. And I want to challenge all of us. This whole series is for everyone. It's for those who are single, wanting to be married. There's for those who are married, wanting to be single. It is for those who are divorced. It's for those who have had just not it's not been good for you. It really has not been a good thing. It's for those who have had pain. And I just want to tell you that I believe this series can then help all of us, okay? I think sometimes we do this and I have people go, oh, well, I'm single. I'm checking out because it's not for me. This whole series is for all of us. And we can learn. A lot of these principles are transferable in any relationship. But how many know there's a lot of pain and confusion and myths about marriage? There is a lot out there that we have been told that is not true. Satan is a liar and he lies all the time about this. In fact, I have a question for you. How many of you believe that there is that one Mr. Right or Mrs. Right out of 6 billion people? How many believe that? Raise your hand. It's not a trick question. It's all right if you do or you don't. Well, I don't believe that. I think that's one of the marriage myths, that you find that perfect Mr. Right or Mrs. Right person. It really isn't that. In fact, I know that God instituted and designed marriage for all of us. And you know, when God instituted and designed it, you need to know, no matter what you're looking at in the world we're living in today, that actually it works. You need to know God designed marriage to work. Come on, everyone say that. God designed marriage to work. And you may be thinking, well, why doesn't it seem to be working well in a lot of lives? Because people choose to think about it and do it their way instead of the way God originally designed it. So let me just make this statement, which will shock some of you. Who we marry is not as important, it's in your outline, as what we believe about marriage. I didn't say who you marry isn't important, but there's a greater importance, I believe, that what you believe about marriage is more important than actually who you marry. In fact, who you marry, the Bible doesn't give us a lot of descriptions of what that person would be like, but it does say this, that don't marry an unbeliever. Don't marry someone who doesn't have the same faith and relationship with God that you do. That's the only, other than that, it doesn't really give us a whole lot of other descriptions of it. And so I'm going to say it one more time because that needs to sink in. Who we marry is not as important as what we believe about marriage. The reason I say this, that when this scriptures were written and when the Bible talks about marriage and the whole subject of marriage and relationships in the Bible, did you know back then there was no such thing as dating? There was no selection process. There was no chemistry thing going on back then. All of the marriages, whether you disagree or agree, all the marriages were arranged. I'm kind of for that again. I don't know about you. I think that's a... Now, let me read a few scriptures that laid a foundation. Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib, and he brought her to the man. At last, the man explained, This one is bone from my bone and flesh from my flesh. She will be called woman, because he saw it and went, whoa, man. And anyway... She will be called woman because she was taken from man. This explains why a man leaves his father and mother and is joined to his wife, and the two are united into one. Now the man and the wife were both naked, but they felt no shame. There's another verse, and we're establishing what God designed marriage for. It's Malachi 2, verses 13 through 15. And God is speaking to the people of Israel because they had backslidden from him. And they were saying, what do we need to do to return to you? I mean, God, we want your blessing in our life. We feel that we've been abandoned. And here's what God spoke to those. Here's another thing you do. You cover the Lord's altar with tears, weeping and groaning, because he pays no attention to your offerings and doesn't accept them with pleasure. You cry out, why doesn't the Lord accept my worship? I'll tell you why. Because the Lord witness the vows you and your wife made when you were young, but you have been unfaithful to her, though she remained your faithful partner, the wife of your marriage vows. Didn't the Lord make you one with your wife in body and spirit? You are his. And what does he want? Godly children from your union. So guard your heart, remain loyal to the wife of your youth. It's interesting, there's a whole lot in that we'll unpack in the next few weeks, and some of it today. But here's a first point. Marriages fail because they focus primarily on chemistry and not commitment. I'm going to say that again. Marriages fail because they focus primarily on chemistry and not on commitment. And listen, I'm not saying chemistry doesn't matter. I think initially the chemistry, that initial attraction of a person being attracted to another person, that is part of it. That is important, but we put more importance on that than we do about what we really believe about marriage. Now, the problem is in Romans 12, they're going to put it on the screen. It's not in your outline, but Romans 12, here's where the warning we got to be careful of. Don't copy the behavior and the customs of this world. How many know what the behavior and the customs of this world are? It's about chemistry. It's about connection. And when I'm not attracted anymore, then, right? It goes on and says, but let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think. Then you will learn and know God's will for you. You need to know I have an agenda. I want to change the way you think about getting married, the way you think about marriage, and the way you think about everything about relationships. I'm here to hopefully renew your mind to change the way you think. Because listen, if your thinking is not right, you're not going to have healthy relationships or a healthy marriage. Okay, so I really want to help us with this. Because see, this idea of initial attraction and chemistry, I'm not a doctor, but I know that God created all that. That initial euphoric feeling is God created, but you need to know that's not what's going to make your marriage last a lifetime. In fact, the chemicals that are actually released in your body, one is called dopamine. Now think about it. That's a pleasure. It creates this pleasure, this feeling. Isn't it funny that dope is in there? Like, you ever think about what was I thinking? You were dopey at the time. You know, and serotonin is the other one, and these chemicals are initially there, but they do not last a really long time. See, people got to understand that initial attraction and chemistry and euphoric, we're going to talk about this in a little bit about the cycles of a marriage, but that really will last about a year and a half. It really does. And those of you that are in love right now are looking at me like you're crazy, man. But those you've been married for a while, you know what I'm talking about. You know, it's not a bad thing. You got to understand the way we're wired and the way God designed our bodies, it is not sustainable to live in that euphoric stage for 20, 30, 40 years. Not one amen, because you guys don't say amen on that when you get in trouble with your wife. See, but here's the thing. God designed marriage to be for a lifetime. And the reason he designed it that way is to provide stability for a home, security, protection, and procreation. Now, I understand that doesn't seem very sexy to you, but God understood when the family is secure and protected and stable, so is the community, and so is the city, and so is the nation. But when the elementary basics of family break down, so does a community, so does a city and a nation. You need to understand, you gotta get that. That's what Tony Dungy was talking about last week. God designed it to be for a lifetime. And so what you believe about marriage is more important than who you marry. Because when all that stuff wears off after a while, what you believe about marriage is what's going to get you through those times. Man, I thought it was better than that. Okay, it's all right. Now, everyone's thinking, but what about, because everyone thinks this, that are in a difficult situation, but what about, God does speak of a few things that give people a reason to divorce. And I'm not even going to focus on that, because even in some of those reasons, God can work it out. But, you know, adultery, obviously, there's places where, okay, that, and adultery, there's another thing about addiction, severe addictions, physical abuse, severe, I mean, obviously, there are those things. But I want to tell you something. In my 30-something years of pastoring, 95% of the people that I see that go through a divorce, it's not about those things. They just don't want to work on it. We just, no chemistry anymore. If this is making you feel, I'm not trying to make you feel bad if you're divorced and you're in a different place right now, but I'm trying to help you now. I'm trying to help all of us understand and redefine what marriage is supposed to be and what we're supposed to believe about it. It's for a lifetime commitment. See, here's another myth. We believe that great marriages don't have trouble. Oh, no. Great marriages will have trouble. Did you know that? That great marriages will have trouble. I've been married 35 years, and I want to tell you something. I've had a wonderful marriage, but there's been trouble. In my marriage, there's been trouble. There's different levels of trouble. I don't think we've ever been in deep trouble, because when trouble comes our way, we don't avoid it. We sit down and do something married couples don't like doing anymore. We talk about it. We talk about what's bothering us. And that's a whole nother, we'll try to get into that. Great marriages will have trouble. If a marriage is based on feelings only and the myth of the right person, then you think when the feelings kind of ebb a little bit that I must not be married to the right person and there's no motivation to work through the problem. So what you believe about marriage will dictate if you're going to work through this thing or not. Because if you believe, well, it just wasn't the right person, I don't know what I was thinking. I mean, I thought I married Brad Cooper, and he's not. He's who's that guy? Kevin James, you know. That's who I married. You know, things have changed, right? Someone like Kevin James. He's okay. I'm sorry. I think he's. Come on, girls. Brad Cooper or Kevin James? Okay. Yeah. Thank you. Let's be real about this. Okay. Great marriages will have trouble. Here it is in 1 Corinthians. Now, regarding a question about young women who are not yet married, I do not have a command from the Lord for them, but the Lord, in his mercy, has given me wisdom that can be trusted, and I will share it with you. Because of the present crisis, I think it's best to remain as you are. If you have a wife, don't seek to end the marriage. If you do not have a wife, do not seek to get married. But if you do get married, it is not a sin. And if a young woman gets married, it is not a sin. However, those who get married at this time will have troubles. And I am trying to spare you those problems. You know, at those times, at all times, there's going to, listen, you need to understand this. There's going to be trouble in marriage. And if your marriage has trouble right now, you are not abnormal. The enemy loves to isolate people and tell you that, well, it's just not normal because they look happy. Every time I look at their Instagram, they look happy. Right? We look at those pictures and go, look, they're so happy. I don't have that. And we believe sometimes these lies about it. So why is there trouble? Isn't that a good question? Why is there trouble in marriage? You got to understand that there's trouble in marriage, and please don't look at your spouse when I say this, but see, your spouse is a sinner. They are. That's not a joke. They're a sinner. And guess what? You're a sinner. See, the Bible says all men have sinned and God is in the process of redeeming us. But when two people decide to get married, even those who call themselves believers and Christians, we are sinners saved by grace. And your spouse is a sinner and you're a sinner, which means that there is this selfishness that's indwelled in us, the me part of us that struggles against the we part of marriage. See, it's not about me, it's about we. But that's not our tendency. Our tendency is you make me happy, you meet my needs, you do these things for me, right? That's what we think it is. So people think marriage is about making me happy, a myth. It really is a myth, and I just want us to understand that your spouse is a sinner, and you are, and our sin nature is really one of our biggest enemies. Satan is the other big enemy. But our sin nature is our biggest enemy of marriage. See, marriage calls us to be selfless. Marriage is a calling to a selflessness kind of life. And anybody that's married knows how difficult that is, right? It can be very hard. And any kind of relationship, if you want to have a healthy relationship, if it's always about you and your agenda and your stuff, I want to tell you something, a lot of people aren't going to put up with that. Some people don't have a lot of healthy relationship or friendship because it's all about me, and it's me. And if you want to have healthy relationships, whether you're single or married, you need to take that simple little joy we've heard so many times, Jay, put Jesus first, right? I think the key, the foundation to any successful relationship, Jesus being number one. Jesus is first, and then others, right? J-O, others, second. And guess where you come in? You're last. Joy, J-O-Y. If you put a little joy in your marriage, you actually will get some joy back out of it. Because there are those cycles in a marriage that we'll talk about in a few moments. Now, just trying to help us, and I'm not trying to be a downer. Again, marriage is wonderful, and it's a blessing, and there is joy, and there are rewards, and it's great, but there's going to be trouble. Can please someone say amen? It's okay. Women, you can say it too. Amen. Okay? And for those that are single that think that when you get married, it's going to solve all your problems, no, you're just marrying trouble. And that's okay, but we all are. And if you come in understanding that, you're not going to be surprised or alarmed in a year or two going, what's going on? Well, nothing's going on. But the enemy likes to tell you, oh, yeah, that person just can't do it for you. And it's such a lie. See, we hear this all the time, and we read this scripture. We have many, many weddings we all go to. We see these vows, this scripture, in every wedding ceremony you've been to. But love is a choice, not an emotion. It really is. So when you're married, if you're in a lifetime committed kind of marriage because you believe it's for a lifetime, believe me, you got to hold on to that one. Because the emotion and the feeling of marriage will ebb and flow. Sometimes you'll feel it and it's great. And sometimes you don't feel it. You don't feel like being married. And that's the reality sometimes. 35 years I've been married this June. Debbie and I, 35 years. And you know what? Every day was, we just feel it, man. It was euphoric, fireworks. Every day I get up, man, bacon is cooking. and my car is washed. It's amazing. Why, every day she does that. Wait, come on, you believe that? No. No, we all, none of us. Listen, in a marriage, you make a choice when you're in tough times. See, love is a choice. It's not an emotion. Listen, it's more than a feeling. Amen. Remember that old Boston song? Come on, can we play that? That's real good music right there. Come on, get your phones out. Come on, listen. Listen to it. Where's that guitar? Come on, let's stand up. Come on, everybody stand. Let's sing it. You guys don't know me. You really thought I was going to lead you in that song? Man, it is more than a feeling. And if you don't believe that, you're going to struggle. And if you're struggling now, this is probably good news to hear in one sense. See, let's read this together, can we? Love is patient and kind. I don't see any emotion in that. Isn't it funny he starts out with love is patient? Think about it. The very first thing he says about love, God is defining love. He didn't say love is incredibly exciting. He goes, no, love is patient. And anybody that is married knows it takes a lot of patience in a marriage because you're married to a sinner. Now, please don't tell your wife or husband that. You know, I mean, we're having fun with it, but love is patient and kind. Love is not jealous or boastful or proud or rude. It does not demand its own way. It's not about me. God's love isn't about me. It is not irritable. It keeps no record of being wronged. It does not rejoice about injustice, but rejoices whenever the truth wins out. Love never gives up. That's not an emotion. Love, man, it's a choice. You don't give up. Never loses faith. It is always hopeful and endures through every circumstance. That's what love is. That's what the God kind of love is. And it's that kind of love that helps us to make that lifetime commitment. Prophecy and speaking in unknown languages and special knowledge will become useless, but love, talking about a God kind of love, will last forever. See, it starts with patience, and you see in there, it keeps no record of wrongs. A healthy marriage, there's lots of forgiveness involved, right? He was a jerk yesterday, or she was just not being what you thought she should be. There's a lot of forgiveness. There's a lot of mercy in a marriage because it's two sinners coming together permanently to live the rest of their lives together. It's like two raging rivers that merge. When two rivers merge, do you know what the first part of that river looks like? There's a lot of turbulence. There's a lot of waves. There's a lot of rough water. It's called white water rafting. And that's what marriage is sometimes. When you come together, it's white water rafting. You're just holding onto the raft. Help! Right? That's what it's about. It's two rivers merging. We hear this all the time. Marriage myth. We have fallen out of love. No, you haven't fallen out of love. You've fallen out of the feelings of it. You're falling out of the chemistry, the dopamine, the serotonin's not there the way it used to be, and you're thinking, but I want it to be the way it used to be. Just not sure if that's sustainable. I'm just telling you, man, I remember early in my dating relationship with Debbie, fun, great, exciting, and we still have fun, and it's still exciting, but things still are not the same. I remember when I was dating Debbie, I didn't have much money, so I planted a rose bush so I can give her roses. Isn't that sweet? Now, maybe I should do that again, but I don't. I don't like working in the yard anymore. I don't like doing that. So some things have changed. See, there's a myth that my spouse should make me happy. Oh, yeah, they should try to meet your needs. My spouse should meet all of my needs. That's a myth. There's no way one human being can meet all of your needs. Now, if you think that, it's not possible. Every marriage, now here's what I want to talk for a moment. Every marriage will experience, this is a cycle of marriage, joy, reality, misery. And then if you're God-centered in your marriage, it'll move from misery to understanding and then a mature kind of love. And you'll cycle through that many times over the years. It's not like you do it one time and we're there. There's always that recalibrating. But, you know, when you think of the cycles of marriage and the joy of it, I mean, do you remember that the joy, the first, the dating, the optimism, he's perfect, she's perfect, they always make me laugh, he's so cute, she's so, all those things. Always thinking about their needs, right? All you can think about is, where do you want, it's wherever you want to go. Well, it's whatever you want to do. And it's just all this give, 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 and you just want to please them. That does change sometimes. I wish I could say I'm like that all the time with my wife, but I'm not. Now, I try to be, but I'm not. The reality is, you can't, you don't live there. And maybe if you do, you can come speak this message. Because the sin nature, the selfish part of me, gets in the way sometimes. And I become selfish, and it becomes about me. And when it's about me, it causes trouble in the marriage. And that joy, that excitement. But how many of you know that there's an ebb and flow in that? And then the reality stage or the reality cycle. And we know that the reality part is, you know, the year and a half later or whatever it is, or, you know, all of a sudden you're irritated. You just get more irritated with that person. The things that you thought attracted you to that person now really bother you. Right? He's so fun-loving. He always has a funny joke. Look, I'm serious. Let's have a talk. I'm tired of you joking. It was cute then. Now it's not cute anymore. Right? Disappointment, irritation. It's just not the same. And you hit this reality part of, oh, man. And that's part of it. And then if you don't deal with it from there, it turns into misery. And misery, there's a bitterness and a resentfulness and an idea of blaming. And then you start thinking, maybe I made a mistake. This person isn't the person I married. And you start thinking of a way out. You start thinking of maybe another person. And you start believing the perfect person myth. I just married the wrong person. I'm going to go find another person, and I'll marry then. I'm telling you, you're just going to be marrying another sinner. I hope you're getting this. I don't know. So where do we go from misery? Let me just read a story to you, and it's so important. This is actually not a story about marriage, but it kind of is. And John is talking to a woman about being thirsty, and in John 4, if you'll just follow along with me, and they're going to put it on the screen, John chapter 4, Jesus talking to this woman at the well, the famous woman at the well story. And Jesus replied, anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again, but those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbly spring within them, giving them eternal life. Please, sir, the woman said, give me this water, then I'll never be thirsty again. She recognized that there was an emptiness in her soul. And she goes, I want some of this water and I'll never be thirsty. And then, of course, he says to her, go and get your husband, Jesus told her. I don't have a husband. She kind of told a half-truth. And then Jesus, who knows everything, said, Jesus said, you're right. You don't have a husband, for you've had five husbands. And you aren't even married to the man you're living with right now. What do you think Jesus is trying to say to her? See, a lot of us think that it's we just need another person to fill that need. We just need another person to make me happy, another person to fill that emptiness. Listen, this lady tried it five times, kept trying to find the perfect partner, the soulmate of her life. After five husbands, she's still searching for living water. And I'm going to say this, if you want to make relationships work, you want to make your marriage work, you need to go to the right well. And the well of living water is only through Jesus Christ. He is the only one that can satisfy and quench our thirst. He's the only one that can quench your thirst. And we think that we're thirsty and empty because maybe it's not, I don't have the right person. I'm telling you, we need to come to Jesus. And for some of us, maybe you've never committed your life to Christ. and you think it's about another relationship that's going to bring you this ultimate euphoric state of happiness, and you're going to be like this woman, you're going to go through five, and maybe not five husbands, you're going to go from relationship to relationship to relationship, continually to be disappointed because you think they're going to meet all your needs. And it doesn't, that's not reality. And Jesus talks about coming to the living water. So important. So what do we do then if you're in misery? Well, you know, one of the things we need to do is we need to sit down in the misery part with that other person and kind of be honest and say, you know, it's not a good place right now. And you need to communicate. You need to somehow start talking. And to get to the place of understanding, it's not about blame. It's not about me. It's about we. You have to walk in forgiveness towards one another. You have to walk in humility and not have pride. Pride is what will continue to create arguments. You know, you got to both own where you're at, not one person and not the other. See, those who are committed to a God-centered marriage will move to this place of understanding, and there are a lot of tools out there. If you're stuck, listen, if you're stuck in a misery stage and you guys don't know how to get out of it, well, get some help. You know, go to one of the turbo married groups that have started out. You know, get into community with other people who are wanting their marriages to be healthy, and they're in all stages of healthiness or unhealthiness. You know, even go to a counselor, a good Christian-based marriage. If you're stuck, get someone else to come in and help you guys get unstuck. Because see, if you are a follower of Christ and you're saying we believe in God, and we believe in the Word of God, then you have to believe what He believes about marriage. It's a lifetime commitment. I know in the culture we live in today, people are shocked by that, but God tells us that it's so important that listen, if it's a lifetime commitment, if it truly is a lifetime commitment, then you have a whole lifetime to work it out, right? I mean, if it's a lifetime commitment, say, you know what? It's going to take some work, but we're going to work this out. I can't tell you how many times I've had people tell me after their second and third marriages, I wish I would just try working on the first one. And again, you know, what's past is past. You can't change yesterday, and I don't want you to feel condemned about that, but you need to know. We need to redefine what marriage is supposed to be. Expectations unsaid will go unmet. That's part of figuring out that person and their language. That no, we can't meet all their needs, but we need to know what their love language is. You know, those things that communicate to that other person. There's a book called Five Love Languages for Marriage. I encourage you to get it. A lot of times, a guy can really be trying, but he's not in the love language with his wife. Maybe she's wanting him to, you know, his love language is to buy her gifts, showing love to her, but her love language is, if you would just vacuum for me a little bit and unload the dishwasher and take, man, that's sexy to me, right? Or vice versa for a woman with a man trying to figure out, it's part of beginning to understand. And again, listen, I'm going to say this, ladies, guys are clueless. If you don't tell them those needs or expectations, but it's obvious. Listen, it may be Captain Obvious to you. He doesn't have a clue most of the time. I don't even know how to land this, but I'll say this. Believers in Christ are called to work it out. We're called to work it out. I don't care what the behavior and the customs of the world are. I don't care what your friends are telling you at work. Get rid of the bum. Right? I just know that with the power of the Holy Spirit and putting God back in the middle of it, and recommitting yourself to a process, not an overnight, it's going to happen. I just think God can help you. I've seen many, 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 many marriages that were really not in a good place restored. You need to know there's hope. You got to believe there's hope. It doesn't have to stay in a place of misery. It can get better. Will it ever be perfect? No, but it can get a lot better. I'm going to pray on all, for all of our campuses, just for people that are in any kind of relationship, but particularly for those marriage relationships right now. Just bow your heads. God, soften our hearts. Soften, God, the heart of that man, that woman. God, where there's been hurt and things said and things done, Lord, I pray that you would just help them to call out to you. Jesus, we need you in our relationships. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would help husbands and wives to sit down, to have crucial conversations, not pointing a finger of blame, but humbling themselves, Lord, and asking you, God, to begin to rebuild what they once had. I bind Satan, who tries to divide and lie and destroy. We break his power of deception, the lies he may have caused some to believe. Lord, we pray for just the power of your Holy Spirit and wisdom of your Holy Spirit to soften and work in these marriages, Lord, that they would come to a greater place of understanding. And God, just that mature love they'll grow into, a love that is patient and kind, a love that keeps no record of wrongs, a love that isn't selfish, a love that seeks out the needs of the other person, Lord. Lord, I pray for those who have never really experienced the living water. They're thirsty, their soul is thirsty. And Lord, they realize today that it's not going to be filled with another relationship, a boyfriend, a girlfriend, that the only one who can satisfy, who can quench that restlessness, that thirst that we have in our souls, it's you, Jesus. Lord, I pray that they would come to you. That right now they would admit that they're thirsty and empty. And Jesus, even in this moment, as they open their heart to you, and they just say, come, Jesus, come into my life. Fill me. You're the only one that can meet my needs. And my greatest need is forgiveness and acceptance. I've been rejected so many times, Jesus, but I know that you love me and you accept me right where I am. I accept you, Jesus, as my Savior, my friend, my leader. Fill me. Let me be satisfied with you and you only. In Jesus' name.